It was delicious. Welcome to the Monday night Bible study. And as you know, my name is Shalom Doty. You can call me Shalom or Doty or Mimi. It doesn't matter. Our format on Monday is welcome, song, prayer, and sharing, and comments are welcome in closing. Mimi is my grandma name, but over at there was a site called The Life Chat, and I went there during the time when my husband was dying, and I didn't want to be Doty or Shalom. I wanted to be kind of invisible, which didn't actually last long, and so I was Mimi, which is my real name, grandma name. Our song tonight is Thank You, Lord, by Don Moen. And we're going to listen and then type done.
With a thankful heart and a song of praise, we've come to you, gathered in this place, for the things you've done, and for who you are. We worship you with a thankful heart, with a thankful heart, and a song of praise. Come to you, gathered in this place, for the things you've done, and for who you are. We worship you with a thankful heart.
So we lift up.
So we lift up our praise, and we lift up our sacrifice to you. Lord, we offer our prayers, and we offer our lives in gratitude. For all you do, we worship you with a thankful heart, with a thankful heart. We will give you praise. You've been so good, covered us with grace. You have been our strength in a time so dark. So we worship you with a thankful heart.
So we lift up our praise.
We lift up our praise. We lift up our sacrifice to you. Lord, we offer our prayers, and we offer our lives in gratitude.
We lift up our prayers.
We lift up our prayers. We lift up our sacrifice to you. Lord, we offer our prayers, and we offer our lives in gratitude. For all you do, we worship you with a thankful heart. We worship you with a thankful heart. Oh, we give you thanks. Oh, we worship you, Lord. 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 Oh, we give you thanks.
Oh, Father God, we come to you tonight. We join our hearts with yours. We thank you for the Lord Jesus, who gave his life so that we could live and have an abundant life. Lord, we thank you for our various countries where we live. We ask you to be with our leaders in each of our countries and in the states where we live as well. Father, we thank you for each other. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for friends. We thank you for love. We thank you for the beauty of creation that surrounds us. So, Father, as we gather here tonight, I ask that you help us to set aside every care and worry of this day, this week, this year, this month, and simply be with you for this time. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm glad to see you all. We have been spending time pondering how we can give praise in those times, in those moments. And we all have those moments where we get a diagnosis that we never wanted to hear, or someone we love gets that kind of diagnosis, where we run out of money before we run out of month, where our job downsizes us or a friend ignores us. It could be a simple thing that's small or a thing that's huge, and it just sends us over the edge, right down into the miry clay. And we need the Lord to lift us out. But one of the ways that he does is by us remembering what we know and being able to praise him. So I ran into this little book with a list of 30 things, 30 days of praise and gratitude to God. And we've been going over them together. So far, last week, we consider that we can always thank God for salvation. Oh, hi, Luana. Welcome. And also that we can thank him for this day, in part because no matter what this day brings, God will be and is with us in the day. And also because we're here. We woke up and we have his breath in our lungs, meaning we have life. So we can thank him for salvation. And we can thank him for this day, even if it has hard things, because he's with us. The third one is we can remember to thank God for our friends. I have this little notebook I got, and it's a devotional book, and you can do it once a week, and it has a whole page of things that you're thankful for. And then it has a prayer of things or people that you're praying for, a half a page, and a half a page of things you're concerned about. And I do it once a week. And friends and family are two of the things that I'm always thankful for. So we can remember on those days to thank God for our friends. And the author, this is quoting the author said, "In our hurried world, we sometimes forget to thank God for those special people that he's placed in our lives. Maybe it's a friend who's always there when you need a shoulder, or one who seems to make you laugh even on the darkest days. Maybe it's a neighbor or a church member, or even a hired helper. Or my friend has she has people who come in each day so that she can stay in her own home. And there could be a neighbor that takes time to help when you're needy, when you can't drive and you need somebody to pick up something from the store. And perhaps you can look over at that list and there might be someone right here among our little group tonight who has touched your heart. Someone that you can, in a sense, call friend, even though we've never met in person. We can thank him for allowing our lives to be touched by these people. And we can thank him for the important roles that each of them have played in our lives. And it may be people that aren't here. And here, look at this. And this one is cute, and it's funny, and it's scary, and it's awesome. And we can thank God that he calls us his friend. That is huge. You might be going like I did the first time I heard that. There's a song that goes, I am a friend of God. He calls me friend. Did you ever think about being a friend of God? I remember years ago when that song first came out, I am a friend of God, and I cringed and I could not sing it because how could I be good enough to be God's friend? And yet the Bible says we are. And we're going to look at that verse in just a bit. I didn't believe it until I saw the verse. And going back to other friends and also to God, but mainly to real people in real life, we can ask him how we can express our gratitude in a unique way to those people over time who have positively impacted your life. And if you're in need of friendship, you could thank God in advance for sending someone special your way. You could ask him. This is what the author said, and then I have a Dodie note. You could ask him to remove the barriers that has prevented you from experiencing the gift of authentic, lifelong friendship in your life. And I would ask God, or consider asking God, if you don't have a friend, ask God to heal the broken places in our own hearts, which may have caused us to build up self-protective walls that keep others out. And I know this can happen because it was something huge in my life earlier in my walk. Because of things that had happened in the past, before I need to run to God for protection, I have built up walls around my heart. And they did a real good job of keeping hurt out. But they also prevented me from having deep, authentic relationships. And they also kept out joy. They did keep people out. In a sense, I was protected from future hurt. But those walls, and a lot of people have them, they also kept love and authentic friendship out. We cannot wall ourselves off from people and God. And remember, Jesus called us friends. We cannot wall ourselves off. We cannot protect ourselves or put ourselves inside a wall without also holding away love and joy. Have you ever thought of that? And I can remember praying and saying, God, I'm willing for you to take away this wall of self-protection. And then about half a year later, I began to experience a lot of emotions that I kept, you know, behind my wall. And I remember telling God, I changed my mind. I want my wall back. And God said, it's too late. He didn't literally say, but he showed me, it's too late. And I'm glad because I don't want to live like that ever again. And here's the scripture that proves that God's our friend. It says from John 15, 12 through 15, and it says, this is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lay down his life for his friends. Now look at this. You are my friends if you do what I command you. No longer do I call you servants? For the servant does not know what his master is doing. But I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. This is Jesus. And this is the verse that convinced me that I am a friend of God. He says so in verse 15, but there's a prerequisite. Did you see the prerequisite? We are his friends if we do what he commands us to do. And the primary things that God commands us to do are to love God and love others. Matthew 22, 37 through 39 says, and he said to him, The man who said, "What shall we do to inherit the kingdom?" He said, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like unto it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself in the same way as and while you're loving yourself." Can't hate yourself and love others. The Amplified Version explains verse 39, and I love Amplified sometimes for explanation. It says, "The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. That is, unselfishly seek the best of a higher good for others." So the way we love others is to want God's best for them. That's good food for thought, isn't it? And now remember, we're thanking God for our friends, and the foremost friend being God himself. Romans 12:10 says, "Love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor." And Amplified explains that and says, "Be devoted to one another with authentic brotherly affection as members of one family." We're the family of God. "Give preference to one another in honor." It's that song that Cormdale and I like to put on sometimes, where the people of God called by his name, washed in his blood and delivered from shame, one holy race, saints everyone, because of the blood of Christ Jesus, his son. But do you see it? There's an old saying. Make a friend, be a friend, and bring a friend to Christ. This verse tells us to love one another with brotherly affection. And Amplified adds authentic. Yes, be a friend. Make a friend, be a friend, bring a friend to Christ. We have all run across people in life and online who say the right things, but they do all the wrong things. They are pure nice to our face and mean as a snake to our back. Or they are snarky to us while claiming to be our friend and loving us, claiming to love us with the love of God. It does not compute. We are instructed to honor others. We may not like them, but they were created by God in his own image. And as image bearers, or just as God's creation, we honor them. And another popular saying is, you catch more flies with honey than vinegar. You ever heard that? Your mother tell you that? And see, some people are wounded. They're just so wounded. They're so hurt. And they're so in need of healing that they do annoy us, just like a pesky fly. But we are still to treat them honorably. What if we could see past their actions to their broken heart? Could we then make a friend, be a friend, and bring a friend to Christ? And then Jesus would change them, but that's not our purpose. The next one, the next verse is a great reminder. Remember, we're thinking that we can thank God for friends. It's Ecclesiastes 4, 9, and 10. And it says, this is a cool scripture. "Two are better than one because they have a good reward for their toil. For if they fall, one will lift up his fellow. But woe to him who is alone when he falls and has not another to lift him up." And you know, that could be a literal fall or a spiritual fall, a fall from grace, of forgetting who we are and who we belong to. and how we are instructed to live. Do you ever need someone to lift you up? Or actually, is there anybody here who's never needed someone to lift them up? A friend to remind you what you know is true but have forgotten? A friend to hold your hand and help you go to Jesus to find his help in a time of great need? I have. And I have had the honor of being that sort of friend too. Have you had the honor of helping someone who's hurting so very badly? I have friends who are widows. Some of them were widows before me, and some of them were widows after me. And most of us knew each other before we were widows. And the ones who were widows before me were able to help me in a way that other people could never understand, especially the ones who had also been caregivers for a long time. And then, not even a year after my own husband died, I got to walk alongside four ladies and help them in a way that, you know, someone else that had never experienced being a caregiver and then being a widow could do. And so God is good. And he gives us just the right friends, and he lets us be a friend. You don't need to have any words. Do you know, have you ever heard this, Luann? I've got to give you this. Everybody look at this. It's what the biggest gift you can give anybody, the biggest and the best gift, is the gift of presence. And what the gift of presence is, it means just being with them. You don't have to fix them. You don't have to have the right words. All you have to do is be there. And yes, it's hard sometimes to just sit and let someone weep and tell them it's okay. You can cry. It's all right. It's called the gift of presence. And sometimes they say it like this. The best, P-R-E-S, the best present we can ever get and ever give or get is the gift of presence. And you know what? When you think about it, that's what Holy Spirit does for us. He is always present to us and with us and for us. But sometimes we're not aware of it. And so the author has a suggestion, something that we could do, an action point. They said, think about maybe five closest friends God's given you, and it could be somebody you don't see anymore. Spend some time today to pray intentionally over these people. Maybe send them a text or send them a little note in the mail and to encourage them in their week, or phone call. And by the way, hi, lady. We're so glad to see you. We're talking about things that we can be thankful for when we forget, when life has caused us to feel like there's nothing to thank God for. And the first one is salvation. We talked about that last week. The second one is the gift of today, because if we're alive, we have his breath in us. And we've been talking about friends, and that Jesus is our foremost friend. And you can read what we just wrote. That is a part of Celebrate Recovery, to remember and to send a note to someone who has blessed you. I have seen people here, right here. I see people right now who have been friends to others when they're down. And maybe if there's somebody here, or somebody that's not here at the moment, but that you know online, besides just people in town, maybe a private thank you, a DM, a note, or a text in real life. And the next one is very different. We've had salvation, we've had for the gift of today and the gift of friends. And this one is completely different. We could thank God for power over the enemy, even when it doesn't feel like we have any power over the enemy, because we do. And the author says, this is quoting from the article, When our hearts are full of praise, our lives are full of power. One of the best ways to exercise power over the things of the enemy is to be in a spirit of praise throughout the day. And we can thank God that through Christ, we do have power over the enemy. He said, or he, I don't know if it's she or he, because it has, it's a compilation. Remember to speak the words he'd have you speak and pray that you would be mindful of the enemy's attacks. And we could ask God to help us remain in an attitude of praise and resist the enemy's advances. And Dodie note, never forget, we enter his gates with thanksgiving and we enter his courts with praise. Psalm 100 verse 4 says, instructs us, enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his name. And Psalm 22:3 says, if that's not enough encouragement, Psalm 22:3, and I like King James for this, it says, but thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel. God inhabits the praises of his people. Open your mouth and praise, and he comes spilling out. Ephesians 6, 11 through 18 reminds us of our power. It tells us to put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. And then we're reminded, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, the authorities, the cosmic powers over this present darkness, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. And Dodie note, never forget who our real enemy is. It's not that person and it's not that situation. It's the devil. And sometimes he's using that person or even our own insecurities or wounded patterns of being against us. We may have habits or ways of thinking that are wrong, that don't line up with what God's word says. And that may be so habitual that we're not even aware of it. And the enemy knows it and he uses that against us. You're no good. You're no good. You'll never get it right. Nobody likes you. Blah, blah, blah. That's a bunch of lies. And remember the first boy from way back in the garden? Yes, it does, Luann. It was to get us to doubt God, as in Genesis 3:1. Did God really say? It says, now the serpent was more crafty than any other beast of the field that the Lord God had made. And he said to that woman, did God actually say, you shall not eat of any tree in the garden? Or even deeper, the devil likes to say, is God really good? Maybe our own mind. Does God really love and care about me? So remember who the enemy is. And continuing in Ephesians 6 with verse 13 to 18, it says, therefore, because we know who the enemy is, therefore, take up the whole armor of God so that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all else, to stand firm. He's saying stand three times in a row. Look, stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth and having put on the breastplate of righteousness and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace. And then in all circumstances, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. And to that end, keep alert with all perseverance, making supplication for all the saints. And I think I think these verses are giving us marching orders, clear direction, and at the same time reminds us that yes, we do have an enemy, but we are quite the opposite of powerless, and God has given us the truth and the strategy to defeat the actually already defeated foe. 2 Timothy says, because when Jesus was on the cross, he said, it is finished. Have you ever heard, people go like, well, if the devil's already defeated, then why is the world like it is? Well, it's like in some war, the war with the Japanese, I believe, and there was a peace treaty signed. Now, this was before the internet. So there was a peace treaty signed, and the war had ceased. But over on this island, nobody had yet gotten the word that the war was over. The enemy had been defeated. He had given in. He had surrendered, and the war was over. However, on that island, because they did not know where they stood, real bullets were still flying, and real men were killed after the peace treaty was signed. It's kind of like that. We have to know that, yes, the enemy is defeated. And, yes, he's going to try to still throw some bullets at us, but he's defeated. And we are with Jesus. We are lined up with the one who has already won the victory. The price, the penalty for our peace has been laid upon him already. Okay, next verse is 2 Timothy 1:7, and we're talking about thanking God that the enemy is defeated and that we are not powerless. For God gave us a spirit not of fear, but of power, love, and self-control. And we're going to see this one in Amplified. For God did not give us a spirit of timidity or cowardice or fear, but he has given us a spirit of power, of love, and of sound judgment and personal discipline, abilities which result in a calm, well-balanced mind and self-control. Don't you like the Amplified? God did not give us a spirit of fear. He did give us a spirit, his spirit, of power, love, and self-control. Meaning, we are not cowards. We do not have to be timid. We are not cowards. We are not timid or fearful by design. We are, by God's design, given a spirit of power, of love, of sound judgment, but also personal discipline. And when we exercise those or walk in what has already been given, then we will be calm and well-balanced. And I don't know about you, but at certain times, I need to remember our enemy is not them, and our enemy is already defeated. I forget. They are not our enemy, my enemy, and the enemy is already defeated. But remember, that does not mean we will never suffer or go through difficult times. But when we do, we can pray and remind ourselves that Jesus wins. We belong to Jesus, and so we also win because our final outcome is a done deal. And that's when we need the ones we talked about before, that friend, to walk along beside us. We do, however, have a part to play. James 4:7 says, submit yourselves therefore to God. And we've heard that more than once tonight. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Submit to God, resist the devil. And as we stand in and on and with the truth, the devil will flee from us. In my experience, the what is of life, even when it is a very difficult what is, it's much less scary than that land of what if. Do you know what the land of what if is? What if, what if, what if? God is always with us. no matter what we go through. But I don't think he's ever with us in the what if land, because the what if land is a figment of our imagination and a ploy of the devil. However, if we do fall into the what ifs, God will remind us and he will draw us out as soon as we call on him. It's kind of like a version of the miry clay. Do you know the miry clay verse? And I was talking about this the other day in chat, and I'm going to quote what somebody said. This is the scripture. He drew me up from the pit of destruction, out of the miry bog, and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. Amplified says, he brought me up out of a horrible pit of tumult and destruction, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock, which is Jesus, steadying my footsteps and establishing my path. And then, this is what Coram Deo said in the chat room, and I told him I was going to quote him. Here's exactly what he said. Hey, Nanny Dove, we want to pray for you at the end, so try to stick around. We're almost done. Coram Deo said, used to tell my students, there are no what ifs in the kingdom of God. He is sovereign. Isn't that good? There are no what ifs in the kingdom of God. He is sovereign. And my comment back to him was, right, God taught me that. He said, God said one time, you know, into my heart, into my mind, he said that he is the Lord of every single what is, but he is not the Lord of what if, because that is imaginary, and what if land excludes faith and trust. Isn't that cool? He is the Lord of what is, but not what if. And Nanny Dove, may I share? Nanny Dove, just went through something that nobody ever wants to go through. She just Saturday, I think, went through the death of her husband, and it wasn't exactly expected. And so if Nanny Dove had thought about that ahead of time, she would have gone into what if land. And she probably did, because I think most people that experience that have been in at least a little bit of the what if land. But when it came right down to it, God was with her. And he was with Dave, and he was with the family, because I've seen some of the things she's talked about. So I want to pray for Nanny Dove. And I want to pray for us too. So Lord, we just thank you. Lord, we thank you that we are not powerless, that we are not alone, that we are never lost, we are never out of your sight or out of your mind, that we do not have to go to the what-if land, because we can know without a shadow of a doubt that no matter what happens to us, you are Emmanuel, God with us, and you are I Am, all we need. You are sovereign, you are omniscient, and you are omnipotent, and you knew it, and you know it, and you are with us. So, Father, I ask you to continue to be with Nanny Dove, to uphold her, to enfold her in your love, to comfort her. And I ask for everyone else here too, Lord, that you would be with them. We ask that you would be with those who have computer issues, because that's so frustrating, especially violinists and anyone else. We ask you to just bless us, Lord, and help us to remember who we are and whose we are. We thank you that you have a specific plan for each of our lives, and that your plan is a good plan. No matter how it looks, you're always working. We thank you for your divine plan. We thank you for your perfect timing. We thank you that you always want your best for us. And Lord, I pray that you would help each one of us to trust you more, to hope in you more, to love you more, to praise you more, to be grateful to you more. And Lord, help us to be patient as we wait for you to work all things out for our good. And I want to share three truths to remember when God asks you to wait. And this is by Abby McDonald. Sometimes it's not yes, it's not no, and it's just wait. Oops. In my book, it said to read this article, but I wanted to just pull this for you. Something for us to remember, and there's scriptures. And this is not me. This is someone else, but sounds like me. God hears you. Regardless of whether it feels like it or not, God does hear our prayers. He may not be answering them in the way we would like or at the time we would like, but he delights in us coming to him with our needs, our requests, and our hopes. God does not, this author says, reminds us, God does not get tired of hearing us repeating the same request, and he does not become impatient because we are needy. And this author said, and I think we've all probably felt that way, sometimes when I repeat myself to God, I imagine him seeing me as a whiny child. But he's holy and loving, and his ways are not like our ways. And if we are truly seeking him and his will, he will deliver. Not in our time, not in our way, but in a way that's good. And 1 John 5:15 says, and we know that he hears us in whatever we ask. And we know that we have the request which we have asked of him. And the second thing of the three things to remember when God isn't on our timetable, instead of going into the what-if land, God does have our best interest at heart. Since God is omniscient, he can see circumstances and he can see potential troubles that we cannot. And God is not limited by the time or the physical laws that govern our existence here on earth. And he can see what will happen in 1 year, 1 month, 1 hour, 1 minute, or even 10 years from now. And Lady says, this is confirming that. Who is he that condemns? Christ Jesus, who died more than that, who is raised to life at the right hand of God and is interceding for us. And so sometimes when it feels like, the author said, God has answered our prayers with a no, it could be because he knows a yes is not what's best for us and the unique situation we're facing. And while we may not understand his reasons, we can trust in God's loving character and perfect will. For still the vision awaits its appointed time. It hastens to the end. It will not lie. If it seems slow, wait for it. It will surely come. It will not delay. That's from Habakkuk and his ESV. And the last thing to remember is God is a giver of good gifts. As humans, we often get impatient and we settle for what is good enough. But God wants so much more for us. He wants to bless us with abundance, but that doesn't mean material abundance. He wants to bless us with abundance and a life that is rich with purpose and direction. And all of us have purpose and we can all have direction. We may be content to settle for what seems good enough right now, but he wants us to wait and trust for something that will surpass our wildest dreams and imagination. And she said, I'm not talking about merely material things, but blessings that fill us up and remind us of what we were put on this earth to do, which is to glorify God. For every good and perfect gift is from above and coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. So whatever we do, this is from the author, but it's good. Whatever we do, don't stop coming before God. If there is unconfessed sin in your heart, bring it to him and trust that he will be just and faithful to forgive. 1 John 1:9 says that if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. think that's what it says. Is that it? Somebody tell me that's smarter than me. And like any other relationship, open communication is key to keeping our connection to Him growing and healthy. And the concluding statement from her little article is, whenever we go tired of waiting, we're probably on the cusp of a breakthrough or a blessing that may look completely different than what we anticipated. Don't give up. Keep pressing into your Savior. And we can be promised that if we do, He will not regret it. Anything we give to God, any trust we place in God and Jesus, will not be of no avail. So, Lord, thank You for this time. Thank You for Your love. Thank You for hope. Thank You that Dave is completely healed and happy, because You said there's no tears and sorrow in heaven. And Lord, be with Nanny Dove and the rest of the family as they go through the next hours, days, and weeks. And Lord, for each one of us, there's things that are difficult that we're walking through right now, every single one of us. So we thank You that You are with us, that You will bring us to the other side, and that even if we fall down into the miry clay and get stuck in this pit of despair for a moment, You will reach down and You will lift us up and You will set our feet back on the rock, which is Jesus, our Savior, our Lord, and, as we learned tonight, our friend. Thank You, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Any comments or questions? Nanny Dove, if you need to talk, go ahead. Oh, let me turn my mic off. Eek.
Mindful of me, that You hear me when I call. Is it true that You are thinking of me, how You love me?